Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Dragonheart, Book 20, Last Day of the Human, by Kirill Klevanski, narrated by Kevin T. Collins. Chapter 1731. On the windswept plateau of the northern mountains, nestled within the serrated embrace of tranquil stone and dark ice, there stood a barely perceptible sanctuary, a tavern that defied the wrath of the elements. It appeared to be the living embodiment of the sole path to salvation for weary travelers in this forsaken land. Carved into the very heart of the mountain, the tavern's facade murmured secrets taken from the ancient wisdom of the northerners who'd once dwelled here. The wooden walls looked like the mighty sinews of the earth itself, striving to bind such an anomaly within the unyielding storm. Each expertly hewn beam and log bore witness to the tenacity of its architects, a people who had waltzed with the indomitable forces of nature, and yet had emerged from this dance, unbowed and undaunted. A series of stone steps led up to a modest outbuilding, which acted as a vestibule of sorts. On the second floor, should one dare to go so far, a cave yawned behind the door, a cave that should have been a gaping chasm, but instead of trepidation and unease, it offered warmth and refuge from the merciless blizzard. Outside, the storm roared with a ferocity worthy of a ballad, almost like it was trying to claim the mountain and entomb its scarce secrets beneath a dense shroud of frost and snow. And yet, the tavern stood resolute, a bastion against the cold, unfeeling embrace of the raging blizzard. As one approached the entrance, threads of light could be seen flitting through the windows, weaving their way through the storm like flickers of hope within the heart of darkness. They harbored a secret of their own, a warm enticement for those who'd refused to yield to the storm's wrath and had found the strength to seek refuge within this sanctuary. The door swung open with a heavy thud, and the newcomers rushed to close it, lest the outside world disturb the delicate harmony within. The air of the cave was laden with the scents of spiced and mulled wine, juicy roasted meats, and the smoky caresses of the fire-breathing hearth. The stone walls of the tavern were decorated with the pelts of beasts, trophies claimed by the locals, and each of them a silent testament to the fact that those seeking the path to the northern lands had not yet given up, and their spirits remained unbroken. The runic symbols that adorned the weapons and armor of those gathered around the tables hummed with primordial power, casting elusive shadows that danced and swirled endlessly around the blazing hearth. Cheerful conversation and laughter abounded, seemingly in defiance of the frosty desolation beyond the window panes. The rhythmic clatter of wooden cups on the tables contributed to the symphony, providing a heartbeat that was normally so conspicuously absent in the frozen wilderness. Men and women wrapped in furs and leather armor exchanged tales of adventure and courage, their voices raised in bold challenge above the howling of the tempest. Within this sanctuary of warmth and camaraderie, the voice of the storm was reduced to a faint murmur, an ethereal reminder of the world beyond. As the hearth of the Hopeless Fool's Tavern blazed and its patrons reveled, the storm's fury seemed to grow impotent, a gentle testament to the strength of those who claimed these mountains as their home. And yet, despite the generally friendly atmosphere, an undercurrent of tension lingered. At the far end of the cave, where most of the animal pelts adorned the walls, some tempting even the most stalwart of visitors to abandon their quest for the Northlands, a large table dominated the room. It dwarfed the others, seating not just 4 or 6 guests, but easily 12 or more. Rarely had anyone, not even the one-eyed bartender, the steadfast owner and guardian of the local hearth, seen the heaven foxes gather in numbers greater than 4. In the 120 years that this illustrious band of adventurers had frequented the tavern, even the other regulars had come to know their roster. Tonight, however, the only ones at the table were a long-winded, red-bearded dwarf who was eating apples, a young man in his 20s whose face was etched with magical runes, and a striking, golden-haired warrior woman who always kept her hand close to her spear. If the bronze-skinned, sardonic man were to join them, an altercation with the dwarf would be almost inevitable, a conflict akin to an unrelenting storm that would engulf the entire tavern. The bartender had grown accustomed to such incidents and hardly cared. The heaven foxes compensated him well for any damage they caused. However, the prospect of sending orders down to the valley, waiting for the replacement furniture to arrive and restoring everything? To the demons with all of that. Yes, they also had a fifth member, a middle-aged man who barely appeared in the civilized reaches of the mountains. He had been seen only a handful of times in the past 2 decades. The bartender recalled the day the 5 foxes had first arrived, tired, bedraggled, and without a clue as to the adventure they had embarked upon when they decided to join the host of starry-eyed dreamers in search of the fabled Northlands, which was what the locals often called them. And for what? Within the tavern, one could count on the fingers of 2 hands the number of patrons who had not attained at least the advanced stage of the Heaven Emperor level, with the majority boasting of being at the peak stage. Any of the locals could have summoned a trial of the heavens and the earth at will in their quest for immortality. The bartender allowed a smile to play upon his lips. There was the answer to his unspoken query. To try was to risk failure. Those who traveled to these mountains could not be satisfied with even the mere possibility of failure, that they might have squandered countless centuries, braved untold dangers and hardships, and even left cherished companions and loved ones behind, all for nothing. No. These natives were not content to simply try. They hungered for greater power. And so, they naively clung to the myths and legends, believing that traveling to the northern lands and mastering the arcane arts would not only grant them immortality, but also a rule. Thus empowered, they could tread the path of the immortals, and after an unimaginable span of time, and with a healthy dose of inexplicable luck, reach the pinnacle of their quest, ascending to the 7th heaven and standing amongst its eternal inhabitants. Fools and dreamers, the lot of them. Those who lived here, the few hundred adepts who dwelt in these mountains, were bound by the ridiculous conviction that mere immortality was not enough. They sought the absolute and nothing less. As a result, they had not descended to the plains for centuries and had long ago forgotten about the existence of the Outlands. The bartender even remembered how the story of the fall of the Raven Sect's stronghold had only arrived with the Heaven Foxes themselves, news that would have shaken the mortal realm of the Nameless World, and perhaps it had, echoed through the hopeless fool for a single evening before fading into obscurity, shrouded in a lifeless frost. It was promptly replaced by a rumor of another passage through the mountains, a tomb of some sort, a temple to the old gods of the north, or some other folly that would drive everyone to venture out, slay someone or something, and leave the bartender without customers for a while. But it was all inconsequential. He had gotten used to it over thousands of years. In a century or two, the next wave of starry-eyed dreamers would arrive, and the cycle would continue. The people who came here refused to acknowledge that even if the northern lands existed, the path to them was blocked by forces far beyond mortal ability to defy. Perhaps the immortals could gain access, but why would they? For the sake of acquiring rules? The bartender was privy to knowledge that many of the adventurers here lacked. Most immortals had no need for rules. Why? Because after ascending so high, freed from the relentless scourge of time, they lived for pleasure. But it would be better not to think about that. Speaking of foxes, who was that stranger sitting there? The bartender didn't think he'd seen him before. Maybe this meant that something more interesting than their recent descent into the northern threshold mine, which had turned out to be a latrine for a stone dragon at the wild god stage, would happen during this decade. What a shitty story that had turned out to be. The bartender, wiping down the cups, hummed and turned to the fox's table. Chapter 1732. Artius waved his hand across the table and whispered a few words that no one could comprehend. Immediately, everything fell silent, the shouts and songs ceased, and even reality itself seemed to warp around the table like the air above a roaring fire. "What is your name?" Artius asked.
"Arnon," replied the stranger who had joined them.
He was a man who appeared to be about 40 years old, with a prominent burn on his right cheek and eyes the color of damp granite. He had almost no facial hair, except for a thin strip of a mustache that he seemed to tend to with the care of a mother watching over her newborn. Artius narrowed his eyes at him slightly and examined the visitor's energy body. Like most of the locals, he was a heaven emperor. The wizard smiled inwardly at his stubborn habit. Over the 120 years that they had wandered these mountains in search of a way to the northern lands, he should have gotten rid of the urge to measure a person's strength. In the countless battles they'd participated in, and which had in some ways secured their own spot in the ranks of the Heaven Emperors, the foxes had learned that strength didn't necessarily matter much here. They had encountered initial-stage Heaven Emperors who had wielded such powerful techniques that their very minds had been shaken by them. Conversely, some peak-stage Heaven Emperors wouldn't be able to survive a single day on their own out here. But that was the nature of things. Casual travelers didn't linger in the mountains for long. They would either perish, return to the plains of the outlands, or, more often than not, invoke the trial of the heavens and the earth. About 3 out of 10 succeeded. The foxes had even witnessed one such ritual, or rather, they had been hired to act as guards. During the trial, an adept was completely defenseless against the outside world.
Thus, it was not surprising that a unique breed of bandits had arisen, hunting down such candidates and killing them at the most inopportune moments in pursuit of their riches. Adepts hoarded their most valuable artifacts, amulets, alchemical reagents, and some even brought along scrolls of techniques and spellbooks for the trial of the heavens and the earth, all in the name of having even the faintest hope of passing the test. The foxes had faced off against a dozen assassins of various Heaven Emperor stages. The battle had raged on for almost an hour. Fortunately, they had managed to defeat the bandits in time to witness the miraculous moment of ascension. Artius would never forget the way the world had shimmered around the adept who'd passed the test. A path of pure gold had unfolded before them, rising toward clouds that had merged into a gateway. With each step along this path, the adept's physical body had dissipated like morning mist, while their energy body, in turn, had solidified, taking on a definite form and ultimately becoming outwardly indistinguishable from their physical body, even though it was not the same. It was then that Artius had comprehended the true nature of the Immortals. They had no physical aspect, their flesh being pure energy. Then the gate had slammed shut behind the ascended, and all that had remained behind were fragments of smoking flesh in the snow, which were soon reduced to ashes scattered by the wind. "Why did I remember that now?" Artius thought. There were no more than 300 adepts in the mountains, and 2/3 of them regularly visited the Fool. Of those 300 seekers, the Heaven Foxes had encountered nearly all of them over the course of their 12 decades here. They had formed a tight-knit collective of adventurers in search of a way to the northern lands, and yet Artius could not recall ever meeting Arnon.
"We don't know you," Albadurt said between bites of fresh bread and sipped from his mug. He wiped his damp beard and mustache before continuing, "And my aunt on my third great-nephew's line."
"The Honorable Alba Udun," the wizard interjected, well aware of the dwarf's tendency to list his numerous relatives endlessly, "means to say that we've never seen you in the mountains before."
"I don't come here often," Arnon replied evasively, his tone dry and restrained.
"And where do you usually go, Honorable Arnon?" Lathia inquired, her gaze clear and steely, her tone stern and heavy. She caused a stir among the males, and even a part of the female onlookers. Artius, however, was not unnerved as he glanced at the simple wedding bracelet around his wrist, matching the one Lathia wore, the one his wife wore.
"To the southern slopes," the stranger replied. "We are exploring the caves of the Far Grotto."
"A Far Grotto?" the dwarf crunched loudly as he bit into his bread roll again.
"I have been in and out of them, and every rune and symbol on the walls has been rewritten 100 times in 1,000 languages. No one has ever been able to translate what they say."
Arnon hesitated, choosing his words carefully.
"That is certainly true, Honorable Alba Udun," he said in a low murmur, causing the trio to exchange glances. "And you have every right, Honorable Lathia, the Shooting Star, and so does your husband, the Sage Artius, to not trust me."
"We don't trust you only because," Lathia cut in, "you wear chainmail under your hides. Do you know how many natives of this area wear metal?" She paused for a moment. "Exactly.
because even enchanted armor made from the finest artifact steel will freeze to your body so hard in the first blizzard that you'll have to rip it off along with pieces of your bones. It was clear from Arnon's incredulous look that he believed that what he had just heard was an exaggeration, which revealed him to be a stranger to these parts. Then the stranger turned around and examined the tavern's guests. Apart from their weapons, none of them had anything made of steel or iron among their clothing or personal effects, only furs, tanned skins, and tanned leather.
"But I got here all right, and it's a real..."
"A real what?" Albedurt interrupted for the umpteenth time, then picked up another mug of mulled wine from the table.
"If you call that a storm,"
he waved his mug at the window, spilling some of the wine,
"then, man, have I got some bad news for you. It's not a blizzard. It's a snow hare's fart. There's going to be a blizzard next week. It'll be so harsh that your balls won't just retract into your body. You'll cough them up along with your lungs if you don't take all that steel off. May the hammers of my ancestors forgive me."
Artius nodded. "Which leads us to one simple conclusion, Honorable Arnon," the wizard continued. "You are not from here, but you know about the deep grotto and its writings, and you're trying to give us the impression that you know our identities."
"Honestly,"
Arnon coughed into his fist,
"the identities of the Heaven Foxes are known to a lot of people in the Outlands. Your role in the fall of the Raven sect is no secret."
"Of course, honored guest," Lathea nodded, leaning slightly on Artius's shoulder. "But we're only geographically in the Outlands at the moment."
"I understand."
"If you really understand," Artius placed his hand next to his staff, "allow me to take the time to explain myself, or else whatever sect, hidden or otherwise, clan or guild name you speak, we will be forced to react to your presence in a very unpleasant manner, and..."
"Fucking wizards," the dwarf burped. "You need to learn how to make actual jokes. Tell it like it is. We'll beat that venerable man until he's black and blue."
Arnon exhaled.
"I'm really not from around here. You're right about that. And I apologize in advance for lying to you, but there are certain circumstances that prevent me from telling you the whole truth."
The stranger looked directly into Lathea's eyes for some reason that did not please Artius, and not even because it made him jealous. "Then our conversation is over," he said bluntly and dryly.
"Wait,"
Arnon said a little louder, and then he looked around the tavern as if to make sure no one could see them. And then he took off his gloves, rolled up his sleeve, and put his hand on the table, pulling back his chainmail.
"I am not a native in the sense you're referring to with that word, and I am not from the families or clans of the Outlands. I am the one true kind of native."
"There are no organizations in the mountains," the dwarf hiccuped. "What kind of bullshit are you?"
He didn't finish speaking, and Lathea almost grabbed the spear beside her. Arnon's hand gradually changed its appearance until it looked like something between a wolf's paw and a human hand.
"My name is Arnon, son of Gark Aller."
The stranger's tone now sounded more like a growl, and his gaze never left Lathea's face.
"And I need to speak with Hadjar."
Artius shifted his gaze from the clawed hand to his wife's neck, where the whitish scars given to her by Fedenrir's children still lingered. Damn it all. Chapter 1733.
A man who seemed to defy time itself stood on a rocky peak. His body was lean and sinewy, every muscle shaped not by the gentle caress of nature, but by the relentless forces of the wild. This was a man who had fought battles not only against intelligent beings, but unimaginable phenomena and elements. His body was a testament to a life filled with the struggle for survival. His face was framed by a thick black beard, its color drawn from the deepest shadows. Long strands of gray hair flowed down his back, kissed by the wind whistling through the rocks, as if the storm brewing in the distant mountains recognized him as its kin. His skin bore the marks of countless battles, each scar a reminder of the iron will that had guided him through adversity. These scars had become his armor, a shield forged in the fires of tribulation, a tangible testament to the strength he had forged with his own two hands within the crucible of unrelenting conflict. He stood on the mountaintop, sword in hand, its blue blade adorned with the hovering silhouette of a quetzal bird. His eyes were firm, his gaze cutting through the air like steel. He also looked ahead with the calm detachment of a seasoned warrior, one who had gazed into the abyss itself and never succumbed. With a fluidity and grace born of centuries of practice, he moved through the intricate patterns of his swordsmanship, each swing, parry, thrust, and lunge, weaving a verse in an ancient song of steel and blood. The wind danced around him, icy tendrils intertwining with his hair, paying homage to a master whose visit was nearing its end. There was a serene grace in his every subtle step, a deadly elegance that spoke of the countless hours he had devoted to the art of the sword. His movements flowed like a river, more elusive than the touch of the wind on nature's canvas. In this warrior's stances, such a harmony of strength and precision seemed innate, as if it were something he had been born with. There was a quiet intensity in his eyes, a smoldering fire betraying the relentless longing that had brought him to this land. After all, he was not a poet, nor a musician, nor a father, nor a husband, just a warrior who had been tempered in the flames of endless battle to become something more. A man who never stopped striving to forge his own destiny in a crucible of conflict as old as the universe itself. With each strike, accompanied by the fierce will in his blue eyes, the mountain beneath him trembled, its ancient stones resonating with the song of his blade. As it froze and then shattered with a mighty swing, it rang with the echo of a northern storm, one that had absorbed all the fury and will of a man who had defied the gods. A streak of blue wind shot out within a ribbon of light, and then, somewhere off in the distance, a loud rumble filled the air. Near the horizon, one of the mountain peaks sliced through cleaner than a garrote slices through a wheel of cheese, began to slide downward. Hadjar exhaled and covered his eyes, calming the heart that threatened to burst from his chest and the rivers of Therna in his soul. "Analyze," he ordered simply. "Processing request. Processing. Host, Hadjar Darkhan, Wind of the Northern Valleys. Level and stage of development, the advanced stage of the Heaven Emperor level. Bodily fortitude, star artifact level. Types of Therna the host possesses, the abstract units listed in the database as will, heart, and mind. Metaphysical concepts the host possesses, the abstract unit listed in the database as the true name of the North." Hadjar clenched and unclenched his fist.
For the past 120 years, he had spent most of his time training and meditating. Only once every few decades would they gather as a group to fulfill a wealthy patron's request, because they would be promised valuable artifacts and reagents that could be used for their own development in return. Or they'd gather to try their luck with a new quest, drawn in by rumors of a possible passage to the Northlands. Truth be told, if not for the note Badur Pagared had left him on that day, the mad general might have long since concluded that he'd simply been dreaming, that there had been no northerner who was the son of Prince Starodub, and that it was all just a fantasy he'd concocted. And yet there it was, the note. Hadjar unfolded the parchment once more and read the words.
Breath of ice, do not be afraid. Go forward boldly, my friend. I will be waiting for you on the other side of the border.
For many years, the five of them had pondered these words. They had grasped at any straw that might lead to their goal, but it always turned out to be false, or another piece of the mosaic that would never fit together. They'd even tried to find their way back to the Calm Mountain School, but after the general's visit, the inhabitants had apparently decided to isolate themselves from the outside world as much as possible, and were now impossible to find. As a result, for the past 20 years, without giving in to despair, Hadjar had tried to make progress on his path of sword mastery. Knowing that there was a rule ahead of him, something that could completely encapsulate his sword, was keeping him motivated, but he had never achieved much success. The result of his endless training and countless battles within the illusory world of his neural network was that, since he'd defeated all other opponents, he now fought relentlessly against the most powerful opponent stored in his neural network's database. Battle simulation analysis, Hadjar requested, adding immediately, in rounded percentages. He didn't need to see numbers with more zeros than could fit on a piece of parchment. Processing request. Processing. Simulation. Battle against the entity known as Helmer. Wins, 0%. Losses, 99.9999%. Ties, insignificant, tending towards 0%. Although he still didn't know the full extent of the Lord of Nightmares' power, he knew that he was a subordinate of the Demon Prince. And that was generally nothing to sneeze at, especially considering the fact that the prince was one of the strongest beings in the Nameless World. He was on par with the Queens of the Fae, the Jasper Emperor, and the master of almost all words, Ash. Unfortunately, Hadjar's path would eventually lead him to clash with all of them, the five strongest entities of the Nameless World.
What do you call that stance? A familiar voice sounded behind him.
Hadjar turned and changed his training robe into his familiar blue one with flowing clouds and stars at its hem. Even Shock, who had reached the zenith of his power, could not boast such light clothing. He had added several skins to his leather armor, and had also wrapped himself in the fur of the ice bear that had nearly taken his eyes and had left him with some serious scars that stretched across his face from ear to ear. Chapter 1734. And then there was the artificial nose that Artius had conjured for him. It looked a bit amusing, but who needed beauty to impress cultivators? There wasn't an adept among the people here who couldn't spend hours examining their own nude body and pointing out various scars and wounds, and then telling stories about the border between mortals and the northern lands. Hadjar turned to the distant peaks, one of which he had slashed with his sword. With that single attack, he had been able to subdue both Tarisfall and the one whose clone Tarisfall had turned out to be. He'd been the clone of the Master of the Raven sect, in one of his neural network's simulations. At this point, his Sword of the Wind Path technique had three forms, the same as 100 years ago. The offensive Endless Wind, the counterattacking Headwind, and the defensive Monsoon. And all in all, out of the dozens of techniques he had practiced in this past century, half of them could have been included as forms, but...
I don't think that makes sense, my friend, Hadjar shook his head. Like the techniques in general...
First of all, barbarian, I am not your friend,
Shock grimaced, then sneezed and wiped his upper lip. He cursed in the language of the Sea of Sand and wrapped himself tighter in his furs.
Damn cold. And secondly, you better calm down with that rule thing of yours. Just write your technique down in an abbreviated form, then sell it to the Twilight Secret sect. I'm sure I will pay you a ton for it. We'll buy a bunch of resources, break through to the peak stage, and try to pass the trial.
Shock had been one of the first to reach the Heaven Emperor level, but unfortunately, he'd gotten stuck in the middle stage and could not advance any further.
I'm not going to stop you, shitskin, the dwarf said as he trudged through the snow. I have to get out of here. Dwarf, you... Hadjar, my friend, the dwarf continued, ignoring the desert dweller. We've brought a very interesting person for you to talk to. Don't kill him right away, all right?
Hadjar stared at the dwarf. Artius and Lethea, who'd been walking behind him, stepped aside, and by the light of the evening stars, it took a great deal of effort for the general to resist the urge to grab his sword. There was a familiar face behind them. He'd been part of Narnir's pack when the wolves had taken Lethea.
You. Hello, Master Wind of the Northern Valleys, the shapeshifter bowed. I have come with an offer.
An offer, his voice rumbled, turning into a storm. Give me one reason why I shouldn't send you back to your ancestors right now, wolf.
Your anger is just, warrior, replied one of Fedenrir's sons. There is blood between us, and I also have every reason to try to kill you. But instead of fighting, let's try to form a temporary alliance. I think you might find the information I have quite intriguing.
Don't keep me waiting, then.
They stared into each other's eyes for a while, and then the werewolf spoke.
The language of the writings in the far cave is the language of my pack. I know how to decipher it.
Interesting, Hadjar blinked, but still not enough.
Of course, the wolf man nodded. But would it be enough if I told you that it points the way to the tomb of my ancestor, Fedenrir?
Some of them cursed, and others damned their ancestors, while Lethea just clung tighter to a now pale Artius.
And why would we want to look for Fedenrir's tomb, Arnon? The wizard asked.
The werewolf smiled, revealing inhuman fangs.
Because it's in the northern lands.
This was met with universal grunts of annoyance, and Hadjar debated with himself as the others perused his current dwelling.
Well, at least some things never change.
Lethea glanced around the cave, its entrance covered by a small boulder. It was enough to keep the modest dwelling hidden from the outside, but not so wedged in as to deprive the cave of fresh air.
It's still as dull as it always was.
The light in the cave, which was reminiscent of a monastic cell, was provided by a single candle. It stood in a small hollow in the wall, just above a simple bed covered with a mattress filled with hay and a simple blanket made of hides. Next to it was a homemade stool and a similar table upon which various books and scrolls rested, accompanied by a lampstand and a few jars of ink. A small shelf attached to the wall held a bowl, a spoon, and a wooden cup. A rug sewn together from scraps of fur cloaks covered the floor. Hadjar was convinced that his theory was true. The further one progressed in cultivation, the more said adept resembled a mortal. Here in the mountains, meditation alone was no longer enough, and the body needed actual sustenance and rest. The pressure of the atmosphere, saturated not only with energy but also with Therna, was so great that even peak stage Heaven Emperors gave up and went to bed every day, or at least every week. They also ate food to nourish their physical body with useful elements. Otherwise, the surrounding energy that accumulated in their energy body would cause their flesh to rot away. Hadjar, who had been able to acquire a star-level body through using the Path Through the Stars meditation technique, did not need food quite as often, but he would still get some food from the tavern once a month when he did not want to spend time hunting and cooking for himself. "Make yourselves comfortable," Hadjar motioned for the others to enter.
"Where?" Shock wrinkled his nose. "Where in this latrine can we find comfort?" "By the rocks and stones," Alba Udun immediately became agitated. "How dare you insult the work of a great mountain master, you filthy shit-skinned?"
"Which has nothing to do with this cave, or am I wrong, little one?"
"Aye," the dwarf thumped his chest. "Carved this cave, so..."
"So I'm right," Shock hummed smugly. "This cave has nothing to do with a great mountain master."
They would probably have fought again if Ardius hadn't stepped between them, leaning on his staff. Hadjar looked proudly at the young man who had matured over the centuries. Not only had he managed to greatly advance his understanding of magic, an area in which he was quite skilled, which was no surprise, given that he was most likely a descendant of Ash, but he had also managed to convey his feelings to Lethea, who had returned them. Hadjar had his own thoughts and concerns, but he tried to keep them to himself. It wouldn't be fair to say that the unity of their group was crumbling, but in recent years they had met less and less often to pursue common goals. Hadjar and Shock were training. Albedert often found himself on mining missions because the 300 locals needed caves much more comfortable and spacious than the general's own. As for Lethea and Ardius, they'd built a house on one of the forest plateaus where they now lived. Lethea occasionally joined the training sessions, but mostly she did something. Nobody but Ardius knew exactly what that was, and the wizard wasn't a very talkative person. He always avoided the subject when it came up, mostly spending his time studying magic and the magic of words.
"I still can't figure it out," Hadjar handed Arnon a mug of beer. "Why did you come to us?"
Chapter 1735. The beer was a symbol of the scant few luxuries the general allowed himself. Every 6 months, he sent a messenger from the tavern to the plains to procure some regular beer. This was a habit that had haunted Hadjar for centuries. He grinned inwardly. Centuries.
His memories of his past on Earth had long since faded to a hazy dream, and yet phrases like "a habit that had haunted him for centuries" still brought back memories of that hospital room and the cripple who'd inhabited it.
"After your fight against Narnir," the werewolf began his story, "things went wrong in the pack. When Narnir failed to overpower the three of you, he lost his status as the strongest. Some thought he was weak and that the pack needed a new leader."
"Beasts," Shock muttered. Arnon twitched at him, but managed to hold himself back. Just in time, too, because if he had lost control, the five adepts would have quickly put an end to his internal conflict. They'd have put an end to all of his turmoil, really.
"My father, Gark Aller," he continued, "was one of them. He was chosen to lead the rebel group, and Narnir decided to turn my father into a symbol."
"He killed him," Artius interjected. Arnon clenched the cup in his hand so tightly it almost creaked.
"He didn't just kill him," he whispered,
his eyes clouding over and taking the werewolf back in time.
"He flayed him alive and then gnawed off pieces of his flesh for a week until my father succumbed to madness, racked with pain and despair. But that wasn't enough for Narnir, so he threw him out of the cave and into the blizzard."
A blizzard in the northern mountains was something not even the average Heaven Emperor could endure. The Therna and energy here were so dense and powerful that the elements became the literal embodiment of the concept of cold. Sometimes, even Hadjar, who'd mastered the true name of the North, would don a fur coat during such times. Admittedly, others would outright seek shelter, but that was a minor detail. "I'm sorry that I can't offer you any sympathy," Lethea said evenly but grimly. Arnon looked at the scars on her neck and nodded silently.
"I understand," he murmured, "but it was too much for me. After all, not everyone in the pack is so belligerent. Many of us just go about our lives. Some of us even go down to the plains when Narnir allows it."
Hadjar didn't need to try and sense whether Arnon was lying or not. He knew that he was telling the truth. Only a few dozen werewolves had come to see Badur, along with Narnir, while Lethea had said there were easily 100 in the caves. Hadjar was grateful that the wolves were simply guarding the border of the northern lands and not hunting the local adventurers seeking a way through. Of course, the fact that none of the regulars at the Hopeless Fool had ever encountered the children of Fedenrir made it clear that no one had ever found the border.
"I broke Narnir's covenant, which commanded no one to follow my father, and ran away from home."
Arnon dropped his gaze to his intertwined fingers.
"I followed my father's trail for 2 days, until I saw him at the end of the cave. He was mumbling something, and sometimes he shook. At first, I thought his mind had left him, but then I realized he was reading something."
"Did you write it down?" Artius asked greedily.
"No, stupid wizard," the dwarf either grunted or laughed. It was hard to tell. "Why would he write it down? So we could take it and kill him? No, he did something far better. He just memorized it."
Arnon nodded.
"But knowledge of the translation is not the only thing I can offer you."
He looked up.
"In addition to the translation of the writing, which, as far as I know, is the key to crossing the border, my father also drew a map."
"Have you memorized that as well?" Shock blinked.
"Yes,"
Arnon confirmed, before slowly pulling out a scarlet-stained parchment. He turned it over, and showed it to everyone. Someone's bloody finger had drawn several maps on the paper. The first was a very meager one, depicting a section of a mountain range. The second was clearly a path through a dungeon, or maybe some catacombs.
"I thought I might miss something, so I kept it,"
Arnon finished, and left it on the table. Everyone in the group took turns studying the drawings for a while, until Hadjar finally asked the most pertinent question. "How much?"
"Do you need payment?"
Arnon was genuinely surprised. Hadjar shook his head.
"You have the map," he pointed to the parchment,
"and the translation of the symbols in the grotto," he said, pointing at the werewolf's head. "How much time did you spend trying to get to the other side before you decided you needed help?" Arnon did not flinch, or even so much as twitch. It was foolish to deny the obvious, and he did not make himself unworthy by denying the obvious. Still, he paused for a moment to think about it.
"About a century," he replied after a minute.
"Damn," Shock exhaled.
"By the stones and rocks and the blazing ancestral ovens," the dwarf tapped his cup on the table.
"Oh, man," Artius said. Lathea remained silent, all the while she held her spear and kept her eye on Arnon. There was no doubt that if he'd made a sudden move, blood would have been spilled. "Then the second question is, why even bother?" Hadjar looked into the werewolf's eyes.
"So you don't care why I came to you for help and why I did so now?"
Arnon gritted his teeth and turned away.
"I am interested in that," the general agreed, "but I'm much more interested in your motives for seeking the Northlands and Fedenrir's tomb."
"Narnir killed my father," he growled, "and I'm too weak to get revenge."
"Then go train," Shock shrugged.
"If I could, human,"
Arnon emphasized the last word,
"that's what I would do, but we can't get stronger in the usual way. The strength of Fedenrir's sons and daughters depends directly on the amount of ancestral blood in our bodies."
"And you need the tomb to draw on more of Fedenrir's blood," Hadjar realized. "And then you'll be strong enough to take your revenge."
"Exactly."
"But you can't cross the border," the general reminded him. "That's just the way things are." The werewolf looked at him with a small smile.
"Did you not know, General, that everything has loopholes? I am the weakest of all the wolves in these mountains. I'm almost like a pure-blooded man. For me, the border is no more than the threshold of a house that can always be crossed."
Hadjar sensed that Arnon was not lying, or at least, he thought he wasn't. But those were just details. It was time to ask the most crucial question. "What's the catch?" There was silence in the cave for a while, then the wolf stood up and walked over to the map.
"There are several of them, General,"
he hovered over the drawings,
"and each one is no less deadly than the last."
Of course. Chapter 1736. Shock, who had been quietly cleaning a nearly frozen fish all this time, almost cut his hand. In this area, even peak stage heaven emperors led an even more difficult life than the average inhabitants of Lydus. Hadjar had meditated on this ironic detail for years, and surprisingly, it had made his swordplay stronger. Unfortunately, he lacked the needed experience and new horizons to deepen his awareness of this mystery.
100 years ago, when...
120, Artius corrected him reflexively, a little embarrassed by the looks of disapproval he got in return.
120 years ago,
Arnon corrected,
when the prince's descendant grasped his rule and wounded Narnir, it really took a toll on him. And then the battle with my father. I'm sure he spent that whole century licking his wounds.
Hadjar already knew that the wounds left by a rule, not just regular techniques or therna, could not be healed by ordinary means. Not through natural regeneration, and not even the rarest alchemical reagents combined into the most powerful of potions would help against such injuries. Only truly special cures could try to undo some of the damage. He wasn't sure what life was like in the seventh heaven, or if it was even necessary to master not only a rule, but also a law in order to become a god. Could it be that the gods lived just like mortals, and the difference between them was exactly the same as the difference between a man and an ant, only not from the usual point of comparison? Each of them had a different scale of complexity, but that didn't change their essence, and... Hadjar? The general snapped out of his stupor and glanced at Lathea. She was looking at his face with a bit of concern in her expression. What is it?
I was going to ask you that, she whispered, trying not to disturb Shock and the dwarf who were interrupting the werewolf. You look like you're about to go back to meditating for 15 years straight.
That only happened once.
It's also why we had to go to the waterfalls without you, and why Artius and Shock have prosthetics now.
Hadjar glanced at the wizard's left hand. He usually hid it under his skins and furs. There were only 3 fingers on it instead of 5, the index, thumb, and middle fingers. The rest had become an ice eel's last meal. It was a hideous creature on the level of a wild god. Of course, that last fact was kind of a given. All the beasts that inhabited these mountains possessed the power of a wild god. Arnon, Hadjar interrupted the argument, then turned to the wolf. Please get to the point. Hadjar did not add that he didn't have much time left. Even by the most optimistic calculations, he had no more than 3 centuries left after the deal he'd made. That was a long time for a mortal, and about a week comparatively for the adepts who'd reached the pinnacle of mortal cultivation.
Yes, of course,
the shapeshifter nodded, and then he pulled several more parchments out of his pocket. Just like the one with the map, they were stained with blood, and some were torn or charred.
This would be the first problem.
Arnon placed them on the table. Everyone else began to read them one by one.
A contract with the Dead Man's Cry Squad, Shock muttered. Are those the irritable gentlemen who wield weapons made from the bones of wild gods?
Yes, the dwarf nodded.
I can't stand them. They're always cutting in line at the tavern for a drink.
Everyone was expecting another argument to erupt between the desert native and the mountain native, but it wasn't to be. This was the rare occasion when they were too busy thinking about how not to die anytime soon to bother with bickering.
Oh, I remember this one, the 17, the dwarf waved a parchment. I'd always wondered why the 17 had such a strange name, and then I remembered that the 3rd uncle of my mother's half-sister's close friend had told me a story about humans.
There are at least 12 of them, Artius said quickly and loudly.
He waved his fingers and the parchments flew off the table, shimmering faintly, the letters on them growing larger and then sliding into the air where they hovered in place.
Dead Man's Cry, the 17, Troll Cherry, Spruce Afternoon, a few individual adepts. By the demons, they even went to the old man.
The old man?
Shock and Albadurt asked in unison. Hadjar grimaced slightly and rubbed one of the scars on his arm. Anyone you met here could be called an old man or woman, especially in relation to a mortal lifespan. However, this resounding nickname had been given to one of the true old-timers of the mountain range. He had come here at least 10,000 years ago and hadn't been down to the plains in all that time. Amusingly, he still looked no older than 40. He wielded a weapon that was both a halberd and a trident. In fact, he jokingly called it a confused trident. Hadjar had dueled him a few times, which had always ended poorly for both of them, with a lot of blood spilled. It had never ended in death, simply because there was nothing to gain from killing each other. Also, in general, except for the bandits, of course, everyone on the mountain treated each other with a certain amount of respect and did not escalate things to a fight to the death, if at all possible. Narnir is hiring a bunch of strong adepts, Lathia said as she exhaled and picked up one of the parchments, the letters above it fading and returning to the surface of the sheet. But why? What good would that do him? He's the strongest man on the mountain already. And that, my dear, Artius sounded genuinely concerned, is why he needs a mercenary force. And if we try to cross the border, it will be in his power to protect it, his wife added, getting it.
Yes and no, honorable shooting star.
Arnon went over and took the parchments, leaving only the one with the map on the table, then spoke after receiving silent approval to do so.
As long as no one approaches the border, Narnir has no right to act. It's like the laws of the heavens and the earth that prevent immortals and gods from directly influencing humans and...
Hadjar! The heaven foxes rumbled in unison, making Arnon shudder. The general just frowned. He had no intention of getting into a discussion with the werewolf about how easily these notorious laws of the heavens and the earth could be bent and distorted, and how much those who were unlucky enough to attract the attention of forces capable of such manipulation had to pay.
Don't mind us, Arnon, Shock held out his hand, gesturing for Arnon to continue. The barbarian has a few scars he can't seem to heal. Philosophizing about their cause is something he does with everyone he meets, if given a chance.
The wolf cast an appraising glance in Hadjar's direction, then nodded at some private musings of his own.
But that still leaves the question Lathia posed.
Artius scratched his stubble thoughtfully.
If Narnir can't influence those who merely seek the boundary, what's the point of hiring adepts? As soon as one of us gets close to it, he'll be able to take over, and I doubt we could defeat his rule, even if all of us on the mountain united to do so.
We could, Hadjar said with conviction, not because he blindly believed it, but because he had witnessed the rule of Fenrir's son with his own two eyes. He knew that even if the cost would be great, 300 powerful and skilled heaven emperors could defeat a single rule.
I can't see Arnon uniting the whole mountain, the wizard commented skeptically.
Fair enough, the general conceded. You're not telling me the whole story, Wolf. Why would Narnir go to such lengths to stop us?
Stop us? Arnon interjected curiously. So, you agree to my offer?
Chapter 1737.
Take your time, wolf boy, Shock snapped at him. We still haven't heard a reasonable explanation.
The fact that you've been snooping around in that remote cave for ages still doesn't answer the question of why you want us there. And you've also glossed over the situation with Narnir and his mercenaries.
The wolf turned to the wanderer and looked at him with less than friendly eyes.
I spent my whole childhood with the traders in the caravans, so let's get everything out in the open, and then we'll think about cutting off your tail, so to speak. Hey, shitskin, it just hit me,
the dwarf smiled smugly, pretending to remember something.
Wasn't your name Desert Wolf? I would never have guessed that you and Arnon are somehow related, huh? By the evening stars, my name is Desert Mirage. Dwarf, that was the last insult you will ever.
Hadjar coughed, and the two friends fell silent. Not because of the general's cough, but because Artius's staff began to glow unkindly. Even though the wizard had once been at the bottom of their list in terms of lethality, 120 years in the northern mountains and the blood of the wizard Ash flowing through his veins had done their part. No one but Hadjar could really hold their own against the wizard in a duel. Arnon sighed and nodded at the bottle of brew. Hadjar shrugged and shook his head slightly. That ended their silent exchange, and the werewolf pressed his lips to the bottle. He took a few large gulps, then set it back on the stone shelf.
After half a century of trying, I realized I couldn't make it through the dungeon, he said, wiping his lips with his sleeve.
Then he took off his hide and leather armor and threw off his chainmail. For a moment, everyone could see scars no less eloquent than the ones that now covered the general's body, and they had been inflicted not just by steel, but by claws, fangs, and something obviously magical as well. The wolf put his chainmail into his spatial artifact and dressed again. Only Hadjar suspected that he wore clothes only because he wanted to imitate a human, and that he needed little more than his own skin to feel comfortable in this region.
And then I began to study the cause of my failures, the wolf continued, and decades later I realized what the catch was, and I also figured out why Narnir and the rest of the pack are just guards on the border and can never get in. It's all about...
Exactly, Artius exclaimed, slapping his forehead. The boundary was created by the queens, Mab and Titania. It's she magic, and like all she magic, it's based on words.
The wolf nodded.
I can't say for sure, but I think you need a name associated with the north to cross the border.
Hadjar is not the only one on this mountain associated with...
But he's the only one, the wolf returned the courtesy from before, interrupting the wizard, who possesses the true name of the North.
Everyone immediately grabbed their weapons, and Thurna and energy started swirling in the air, but Arnon didn't even move. Neither did Hadjar. Only the two of them remained unmoved.
"Nobody knows about this but us, you fleabag!"
Shock barked, grains of sand glittering around his sabers.
"And I swear on my name and honor that I will take this knowledge to my ancestors,"
the wolf nodded, sounding quite sincere.
"And you're right, mage. I could appeal to those who control ice and snow, those who can summon blizzards and snowstorms. The ones who hear the whispers of mountain storms and tempests. Yes, even the wind that Hadjar uses is far from the frostiest among those that the other adventurers here wield. And yet,
he is the only one who can control the north,
Artius finished for the wolf. Arnon nodded.
As for your unasked question, the shapeshifter allowed himself a little sneer and added, Desert Mirage, I've spent the last 20 years tracking the most promising adepts, and I just so happen to trust Hadjar's abilities more than anything else. You've been tracking people around here, Shock snorted. This valley is one of the most protected. I patrol the area constantly, not to mention the charms Artius put up. With all due respect, honorable adepts, the wolf bowed from his stool. We all have our strengths and weaknesses. My strength is remaining unnoticed. It was the only way I could survive the pack as the weakest of Fedenrir's sons.
Everyone was silent for a while. It wasn't like the fact that Hadjar possessed the true name of the North was a top secret, but there was no particular reason to talk about it, especially since, unlike the names that could be used in battle, the name of the North did not grant such advantages, at least not at the level of Heaven Emperors. Despite the fact that it was more comprehensive and included many facets of the essence of the North, Hadjar remained a swordsman. He was not well-versed in the magical arts and the ability to wield the full power of words. Artias had once tried to help him and explain it all. He'd even spent 5 years on it, but it had practically been to no avail. Maybe if Hadjar had had a few thousand years to spare, at least 4 or 5, he could have conquered the North completely, but time itself was playing for the other team. Narnir fought Hadjar, Lathia whispered suddenly. He could sense the name of the North in him. Arnon nodded again.
And when the pack couldn't find me, the werewolf flinched a little at these words, but pulled himself together and continued. It didn't take much for the leader to put 2 and 2 together. Gark Aller's son is missing, while Gark Aller's own tracks lead to a distant cave, and there is the one who possesses the name of the North, right on that mountain. It's not a difficult riddle to figure out.
He might still be waiting for us at the border, Lathia observed. So, there's something limiting him, Artias stretched as he pondered this. Some nuance we don't know about, and that's why he's hiring mercenaries. He won't even let us come near the border.
It was hard not to agree with the wizard's words.
Very well, Arnon.
Alba Udun looked serious for the first time.
What's stopping us from agreeing to wait until you bring us to this dungeon and then introducing you to our steel?
Hadjar answered in the wolf's stead. We can't be sure that the map he showed us isn't a fake. The dwarf swore. He said something about wolves and sheep being related, or something like that. The cave fell silent again, and if you stood still and listened, you could practically hear the whirring of the cogs inside the heaven foxes' heads.
Let's not argue any more. Shock put his fists on his knees. This is the first, more or less serious clue we've come across in more than a century of freezing our asses off here. We can just swear a blood oath and get on with it.
Arnon pulled out a parchment.
We need supplies and some artifacts, he said, looking up from the list.
Hadjar turned and let the stone roll away silently with a wave of his hand. The air was crisp with cold and frost, the approaching storm's eternal companions. The humidity had risen so much that the snow had turned to ice, and the sky seemed to draw closer, looming more ominously with every beat of his heart. The heavy hand of an elemental giant sought to crush the fools who thought they could defy the laws of nature. The wind died down, and only the lingering sense of the storm's approach remained.
Stop hiding, Gaston,
Hadjar said to seemingly no one. I know you and your brothers are here. A blizzard came, and when it cleared, three similar-looking men in their 60s appeared on the threshold of the cave. They were powerfully built, dressed in tanned skins and covered in furs. The first held a huge axe, the second wielded an equally impressive axe, and the third, standing in the middle, held a mace with an iron tip shaped like horns and magical runes along the shaft. I assume you have recently accepted some sort of offer? Hadjar asked quietly, resting his hand on the hilt of his sword.
I suppose so,
nodded Gaston, the oldest brother and head of the trio. Can we solve this with words? Hadjar asked hopefully. Gaston shook his head, causing his thick curls to spill across his shoulders and back. I'm sorry.
So am I, General.
They looked at each other for a moment before Hadjar spoke again. I will see to it that the funeral song is sung over your body according to all the laws and customs.
Likewise, General,
Gaston replied. And with that, they both threw themselves at each other at the same time. Chapter 1738. Atop the snow-covered peaks of the mountains, a fierce battle raged between the mightiest of adepts. Despite their mastery of various techniques and styles, and not even a trace of energy or therna seeping into their surroundings, the very air trembled. It was the sheer power coursing through their veins that shook the atmosphere. Arnon shuddered and crouched. Though he'd lived amongst the children of Fedenrir, he had not always had the opportunity to witness a battle of this magnitude.
Should we not help?
He asked fearfully. Help Hadjar? Lathea did not immediately understand what he meant, and then she smiled a bit carnivorously. Take a good look, werewolf, and then think about whether you should try to trick or deceive us in the future. Arnon looked back at the plateau, where the four were standing. The brothers, Gaston, Aston, and Bastion, possessed enough fame to be recognized in every corner of the mountains, and yet the mad general faced them alone. The eldest, Gaston, wielding a mace forged from magical metal, used a style and wielded techniques that would allow him to shatter any surface the mace touched. There was no point in blocking such blows, and those adepts who chose to experience the oldest brother's blows were either stripped of their weapons or suffered even worse fates. Arnon couldn't believe his eyes when he saw that Hadjar, although he obviously struggled to dodge every titanic blow at the last second, still didn't try to land a single sword strike himself. Aston, the middle brother, known as the Spirit of Fire, wielded an axe that carried with it the molten fury of the Earth's very core. With each swing, Aston's weapon unleashed a torrent of lava, transforming the frozen battlefield into a treacherous river of fire in a mesmerizing dance of opposing elements. Few could have withstood such an onslaught, even if Aston had fought them alone, but here he was fighting with his brother. And yet, Hadjar weaved through the shifting terrain, skimming lightly off the ice and seemingly off the bursts of flame as well. His movements were faster than the steel, and he himself sometimes seemed to turn into a fleeting wind. The youngest brother, Bastion, brandished his axe, and his techniques and attacks felt harder than the stone of the mountains on which the battle now unfolded. Wherever his axe fell, the ground shook down to its very foundations, and the lava and ice instantly turned to lifeless stone, succumbing to the relentless onslaught. An uneasy tension hung in the air, and the wind began to whisper of a battle that would fuel gossip and murmurs in the tavern for a long time to come. Hadjar, who had become known as the Swordsman of the Winds, still moved calmly between the attacks of the brothers. Clutching his blue blade tightly, he seemed to challenge them with his cold-blooded defiance. He navigated the crucible of battle, his footwork a fierce dance, and each step, though it sounded like the elusive whispers of the wind, promised to usher in a storm. And it was not long in coming. Hadjar and Gaston charged at each other again, akin to furious bears awakened in the depths of winter, but this time the general brandished his sword. In a whirlwind of snow, steel, and savagery, their battle escalated. Hadjar's blade sang on the wings of the wind, composing a symphony of destruction that sent the blizzard swirling around him and icy reflections blazing upon his steel. Gaston screamed as a long gash was torn open across his body, the wound spurting blood in all directions, but he only clenched his teeth tighter, and his eyes flashed with fury. He swung his mace with primal power, cleaving the air with a roar of foul thunder, and Hadjar, shrouded in a barely visible mirage, dodged the devastating blow. Instantly, Aston's axe, trailing rivers of fire in its wake, crashed down on the general's head, erupting like a volcano. Hadjar, however, shook off the boiling earth and soared away, momentarily merging with the wind that enveloped him. The lava hissed and pursued its quarry, attempting to encase Hadjar in a flaming sarcophagus. But it was in vain. Arnon could have tried to warn the general, for Bastion was already lying in wait, but such attempts would have been futile. The youngest brother's axe split the air and struck the ice and lava, transforming the battlefield into a trap that should have torn any adept to pieces, but it only served to show off the general's dexterity and skill. Four warriors clashed in a maelstrom of raging elements and steel, and their battle shook not only hearts, but also mountains. All the while, Hadjar weaved between the brothers, shrouded in a ghostly mist and wind mirages. Arnon's eyes could see no more than that. And then suddenly, everything stilled. The seemingly chaotic and meaningless dance of the mad general ceased. Only then did Arnon realize that the three points in the triangle that had ensnared Hadjar were now standing before them. Gaston, his chest ripped open by a wound, could barely breathe, and his younger brothers were panting just as heavily. And then there was a roar. At first, it might have resembled some kind of beast, but soon it turned into a realization. The wrath of an approaching storm was here. The blue blade, giving birth to furious thunder, sliced through the air, leaving an arc of blinding blue light in its wake. A storm of snow, ice, and wind swirled around the swordsman, transforming into a whirlwind of unbridled fury. The three brothers were instantly engulfed by the tempest and scattered in different directions like autumn leaves. Their weakened arms, riddled with countless deep wounds, could no longer hold their weapons up. Flung in all directions, they could only groan and try to summon defensive techniques, but the fury of the wind was unrelenting. And then silence reigned. Everything stopped. The winds died down, leaving only light snowflakes to gently fall on the ground, tired from the swift but brutal battle between true adepts at the level of Heaven Emperors. Hadjar stood before the bloodied corpses. He still clutched his blue blade, which had only needed to strike twice. There was no joy brought on by victory in the mad general's gaze, only mild remorse. The brothers' bodies twitched one last time,
then froze. The mace shattered, the axe melted, and the other axe crumbled into sand. That was the end of the trio's once earth-shattering power. Hadjar swung his sword, shaking off splashes of scarlet blood onto the snow, then sheathed his blade and bowed low, with all due respect and honor, to the warriors who had gone to their deaths with untarnished spirits, will, and strength. "May you be welcomed with bread and honey and funeral songs," he whispered the necessary words, then turned to the others. None of the other foxes were surprised at what they just witnessed. They were well aware of how much stronger Hadjar had grown in the past century. If the ravens had fought him right now, and the mad general had decided to use all his trump cards and push himself to the very limit, he could have taken down their entire sect, or at least a significant portion of it, including their master, all on his own. "We have to go," Hadjar said quickly, as if he hadn't just fought against three powerful adepts. "I agree," Shock jumped down from the stool he had been sitting on and stepped out of the cave. "I don't think those three had the same tracking abilities as our new acquaintance, so it's likely someone shared information about our whereabouts with the mercenaries." Hadjar nodded and turned to the wizard. "Artius, I need 5 minutes," was all the mage said. "Understood." The general nodded again, then walked over to Arnon. The blade of the knife in Hadjar's hand flashed, and blood dripped onto the snow. "As long as we are united by a common goal, we are closer than brothers and more loyal than dogs." Hadjar spoke the words of the universal blood oath and extended his hand to Arnon. The wolf immediately reciprocated the gesture, and then spoke the ritualistic words as well. Hadjar withdrew his hand and allowed the wound to heal. Waiting for Artius's signal, he swung his sword when he received it and sliced through the air, opening a path of the wind, which was by now something the foxes had gotten used to. Arnon was the only one who nearly lost his lunch when the path took them to the opposite slope. He looked at the foxes in confusion, then at the plateau they'd just left behind.
"How are we—"
"Shush," Shock interrupted him,
"or we'll miss the whole thing."
"Why don't we—"
Arnon started again, but Shock cut him off again with a wave. Once more, the werewolf was briefly convinced that his eyes were deceiving him. Chapter 1739. In the heart of the mountain, where ice and snow once reigned, a sudden flash of fiery madness pierced the frozen silence. It was as if the heavens themselves were trembling in anticipation of the moment when the world would be transformed by this violent eruption of an element alien to the north. As the first threads of magic wove through the air, Artius raised his staff and struck the ground. Words fell from his lips, disappearing on the wind like the soft caresses of a seasoned lover. And the earth, though cold, responded with the passionate trembling of one stirred by the promise of what was to come. With a sudden gust that took the breath out of the air itself, an explosion of fire and lightning swirled in an apocalyptic union of primal forces, instantly incinerating the snow-capped peaks with its fiery brilliance. The world trembled beneath the pressure of Artius's magic, and if one listened closely, they could hear the crunch of reality's own bones. Flames roared like ravenous dragons, trying to claim the mountain in a single breath of fire. The snow hissed and groaned under their onslaught, its pristine sheen fading away and blackening beneath the fierce kisses of the flame. lightning, wild and capricious, danced around the fire like fervent priestesses, its sparking touches defying the heavens. The air was saturated with the scent of ozone and burning earth, intoxicating miasmas that reflected the unbridled power of the summoned magic. For a time, the storm of fire and lightning raged across the stone peaks, and the world shook with the howl of a burning mountain. But then Artius struck the ground with his staff once more, and all was quiet again. There was no way to avoid seeing the mountain's resulting transformation. The once pristine mountain peaks had been changed forever by the primordial forces that had descended upon them. The rocks bore the terrible scars of endless dark crevasses, silent witnesses to what had just happened. After the last echoes of the explosion faded into the silence of the snow-capped mountains, Arnon turned to the group, his eyes reflecting a kind of horror. "That was 50 years of spells, runes, and 12 artifacts," Artia said, almost in tears.
"Never mind that, wizard," the dwarf slapped him just below the back. "We will find you a new valley later, and you can prepare it just as ruthlessly. Although my third cousin, who is related to my grandmother by..."
The wolf let out a breath of relief. If the mage had just summoned such an immense power, not by will alone, but after half a century of preparation, that fit a bit better within the confines of his world view. Even so, it placed Artius among the top 10 mages in these mountains. "How many?" Hadjar asked suddenly. The wizard covered his eyes and whispered. The wind swirled around him, kicking up a few snowflakes.
2 are dead," Artius replied. "About 12 others either escaped or used techniques to protect themselves. What happened to them, whether they were wounded or not, I can't say."
So it was at least 15 adepts, the general summarized. Narnir spared no expense.
"Money, whatever form it takes, doesn't matter to the pack," Arnon reminded him.
Shock extended his sabers a little, then drew them sharply. It was a habit he'd picked up during his time in the Sea of Sand.
"The adepts around here don't really care about money either, wolf," he said with a haughty grin. "Perhaps Narnir promised them artifacts or something of equal value."
"Which is of no importance to us," Lethea interjected. "If he can employ 12 local adepts, he can certainly employ more, especially if 5 of them don't need to be paid now."
"Time is short," Artius added, pointing toward the approaching storm. There, on the horizon, the sky was slowly darkening, and the land was merging with the sky through winds filled with a blizzard that would not only freeze an adept, but literally shred their bones and then grind up what was left.
"If that storm catches us in the cave, even Hadjar will not get away unscathed," the mage concluded.
The general nodded. As usual, time was not on their side, and the cave was at least a week away, the same as it had been before the storm had come to this land. However, their original estimate hadn't factored in adepts that would be following their trail. A journey through the northern mountains was risky enough, and with the added complication of mercenaries. Hadjar turned to the mage. "Can you hide us, Artius?"
"For a few days," the mage shrugged. "Then the other mages will see through it."
"At least we'll have a head start," the general sighed.
"I suggest we split up," Arnon held up his hand. "Some of us will go to the tavern and buy what we need. The others will wait at the ice ladders and..."
"My dear Flea," Shock smiled broadly, but it was obviously a fake smile.
The fact that we have a temporary alliance with you does not give you the right to decide for us. By the evening stars, you don't even have the right to participate in the discussion at all. I rarely say this, but the shitskin is right, the dwarf muttered, stroking his mustache pensively as he did so. Lathia nodded cautiously. Hadjar and the wizard looked at each other. If all six of us were to enter the hopeless fool, Artius began, a magical veil wouldn't help. It would only make us irrelevant to others, not erase us from reality entirely, and six adepts buying artifacts and provisions for traveling deep into the mountains, that would be like entering the tavern with no cover at all. Agreed, the general sighed, caressing his beard in a gesture almost identical to the dwarf's. Decades had passed since the last time he'd felt like a young man. He still hadn't taken on the appearance of an old man, as he'd done once before, and he certainly wasn't going to bother with bulky muscles, so he looked about 40 years old now. Due to that, the beard seemed only appropriate, and it was also warmer, which was a nice bonus. Barbarian, this is not the time for one of your mad plans, the slightly alarmed Shock reminded him. No madness here, Hadjar shook his head. Arnon and I will go to the tavern, and you will wait by the ice ladders. That will cover our tracks for a while, and maybe we will be able to buy ourselves an extra hour or two. Desert Mirage started to object, but then waved his hand in a gesture of surrender and cursed in the desert tongue. Artius. Yes, the mage nodded. He raised his staff, spoke a few unintelligible words, and a wave of power enveloped the six adventurers for a moment. Nothing much had happened, but now, as they looked at each other, they saw something so insignificant that they didn't even want to think about it. It was like walking down a busy street in a big city. You see people passing by, but you don't pay attention to them, let alone remember their faces. Give us 4 hours, Hadjar said. If we don't show up by then, wait for us in a safe place. What happens if you don't show up at all? Someone asked. The general couldn't make out who'd spoken, and the voice was lost in the folds of his memory as soon as it stopped talking. Let's hope it doesn't come to that. And if it does, by the evening stars, Barbarian, can't we just think the plan through for once, and only then go for the noose afterwards? If it comes to that, you shitskin, we'll show up at the tavern, send half of them to their forefathers, and torture the other half until they tell us everything. I envy how little brains you have in your tiny skull, dwarf, and Hadjar didn't bother to listen to the rest of the argument. He opened a wind path, and with a wave of his hand, he sent the four of them to the ice ladders, and he and Arnon headed for a peak some distance away from the tavern. As good as Artius's spells were, only a complete idiot wouldn't know what was going on when they showed up at the tavern's doorstep with the help of the wind. And there were no idiots in these mountains. Admittedly, Shock might have argued that there were at least one or two of them. What he didn't know was that Lathia had all the information she needed in case someone didn't show up at the designated safe spot. They'd thought of all the escape routes a long time ago, just in case some higher power ended up disliking the fact that the general was getting closer and closer to the seventh heaven.
You really are mad, Master Wind of the Northern Valleys, the wolf hissed as they left the wind path.
You have no idea, Arnon, Hadjar said dryly, how many times I have heard those exact words. With that, he was the first to begin the descent down the icy slope toward the tavern, looming in the distance.
Chapter 1740. Hadjar and Arnon entered the tavern, capturing the attention of its patrons for a brief moment. But curiosity gave way to indifference as the wind shifted outside the tavern and the regulars returned to their own affairs. It was impossible to say for sure whether this behavior was due to Artius's spell or the general atmosphere of indifference. The same was true for Arnon. As he strode forward, his cloak whispered secrets of the night behind him. Hadjar certainly didn't remember the wizard ever conjuring such things, which meant that the wolf was trying to impress the bartender. This wasn't exactly the wisest move. The tavern's irreplaceable proprietor was harder than stone, with a thick and wild beard that seemed to be wider than the mountains beyond the threshold. Arnon tossed a few vials of the World River's essence onto the bar, and they rang with the song of unfulfilled promises, drawing the regulars back in for a moment. While money really wasn't all that important to the adepts here, the amount Arnon had so casually laid out on the bar just now could buy a few useful things.
"We need enough provisions and protective artifacts for 6 men going on a 2-week journey."
Arnon's voice sounded like the murmur of a stream hidden behind the foliage. Or a snake.
The kind that can hide them from the cold and the beasts.
The bartender's eyes narrowed like a hawk's when it's watching for a rabbit that was being too bold.
"You'll need more than that."
His voice, which was a stark contrast to Arnon's, filled the air.
"If you're planning an expedition through the mountains, that is, the storm will come in a week, and if you get caught by it amid the rocks, even protective artifacts won't save your asses."
Suddenly, Arnon smiled. It was a warm, light, and even somewhat reassuring expression.
"Of course, honored master,"
he bowed his head slightly,
"but we have our reasons. We work for the Twilight Secret Sect, you see, the one that suffered so greatly in the battle against the fanatics of the enemy. Unfortunately, time is running out."
Hadjar almost brought his hand to his face in frustration. Fortunately, the runes that made up the spells around the bar were always glowing, fulfilling their function of hiding conversations from prying ears. It was a rule of the tavern. Whatever was said to the bartender stayed with the bartender. The fact that the words did not go beyond the owner's ears, however, did not mean that he could not suspect that something was amiss.
"This is not a good time to travel," the bartender murmured, his voice sounding like the distant rumble of thunder. "Do not invite the wrath of the storm upon you. I will not sell my wares to those who bring trouble with them. We are a superstitious people here, stranger."
Hadjar would have normally left the tavern after that single sentence. After all, the bartender knew most of the locals. That was why he and the werewolf had agreed that Arnon would do the talking. Magic was magic, but it never hurt to be on the safe side. Arnon leaned closer, and his voice took on a conspiratorial tone.
"A fair point, but we have prepared this expedition meticulously. We are aware of the risks and have considered ways to counter them. But..."
Arnon's hand slipped behind his back, momentarily revealing 2 more vials.
"Perhaps you're looking for some personal gain?"
The bartender remained nonchalant, his expression as unyielding as a steep mountain slope.
"Your words are honeyed, stranger, but I will not risk my reputation by contributing to unnecessary risks."
In other regions, a mortal might have erupted in anger at this, scandalized and outraged at the fact that anyone would dare tell them what to do and how to live. After all, this was their choice to make. They might have even reached for their blade. But that would only show that this man had never lived in the northern mountains, where bloodshed was rare. Not only because there was little to fight over, but also because there was no real sense of competition when it came to finding a passage to the northern lands. The ones who eventually found it had nothing to lose by sharing it with others. After all, who knew what awaited them on the other side of the border? An unspoken rule among the adepts here was to always try to advance the common cause. The artifacts and provisions Arnon was looking to purchase didn't grow on trees, of which there were almost none in this area. They had been obtained with great difficulty. If the bartender sold them indiscriminately, it wasn't hard to imagine their already struggling society never leaving the tavern. But Arnon didn't let that deter him. He straightened, his smile unchanged, and his eyes gleamed not like a wolf's, but like those of a cunning fox.
"What if I were to tell you, honorable master, that our journey could have pleasant consequences for all the adepts here?" Arnon said. "What if I told you that not only are we fulfilling the mission of the Twilight Secret Sect, but that they are merely acting as intermediaries for the Calm Mountain School, the same school that once helped the Mad General a century ago, the ones with knowledge of the Northlands?"
The bartender's eyebrows arched slightly, but his countenance remained skeptical.
"If that were true, you'd have the school's medallion with you," the bartender said doubtfully.
With a flourish, Arnon produced the school's medallion and placed it on the bar. Thanks to his training with Artius, Hadjar was able to see through certain spells. If not for that, he would have been none the wiser about this exchange, a fact the werewolf was unaware of. The general stared in astonishment at the seal of the school hidden in the snowy mountains. Surprised, the bartender hesitated.
"I see you're not so easily swayed," Arnon observed, hiding the medallion in his cloak once more. "Let's say we triple the price." He produced four more vials. "With that, you can order more artifacts, and even if we perish in a storm, the local adepts won't suffer."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.